We thought about a really tacky title for a book. Everybody loves George Lucas, so I thought at least that will stick with your name. Let me start with this one. About 2.5 years ago, I was asked by my employer to move to Gaziantep, which is a nice city in Turkey, working on the Syria response. The thing which differs for most humanitarian interactions, as you probably know it from the news, is that I was working there with a transitional mandate, which means our basis was not life-saving, but everything else. So people rushing to people to stop them from dying. We could do, for example, garbage collection, firefighting, and all other kind of stuff. So eventually my boss asked me, what about all those people who are suffering from trauma on a daily basis? And I said, well, before the uprising, there were about 2 psychologists in the country, so how do you want me to mobilize those? Probably they're on the run. So we said, okay, maybe look a bit into psychosocial support, civic education, non-formal education. We were not going for formal education because we were scared that schools might get bombed. And that was it. So working for a governmental agency with very conventional project work, I started writing a paper saying, like, okay, let's get clowns here. Let's get people who do capoeira and maybe do some LARP. And that's when we invited the Palestinians. So we established already some kind of nice network there. They came over, did initial trainings, introducing people to the topic. And then I said, okay, maybe we put some more on it. Larson was going to tell you a bit more about that.
Yeah, and then Tina asked me to travel with her, and we were like, I had to pump myself up now a bit. We have these 20 years of lab experience, and we made small and big games, and of course, we are both experienced in Nordic and German lab, but actually, what does that mean in the end? So what we did is we traveled down there, and Tina has a lot of experience there, and I have none. I came into a total different culture, of course, with all the stereotypes we all have in our head, and I felt a bit like one of these way too fast growing dogs, these puppies that wandering around and do not really know how they interact with everyone else. And so we came up with a concept, and we tried to tell all the mechanics and the concepts about Nordic or German or other labs, and we of course brought videos from different labs and showed them and explained about that, and we made lectures on creative thinking, tried to make these people think out of the box, what is quite interesting if you grew up in a regime. I mean, how to think out of the box if there's only the box. And yeah, of course, we also taught them the wording, though that they can work in a team and talk about something. So if you don't have words, you can't talk about stuff you want to do. And this all in 4 days, no, wait, 3 days, because we also wanted to write LARPs with them in these 3 days, and they have to be played. So the fourth thing was to play LARPs. That's what Tina talks about now.
So they did some mini LARPs, and I'm just going to pick the 3 most famous ones for now. The first one is called Fairies and Frogs. So there was a very young, mid of her 20s lady, and she said, I want to do something on gender equality, and I'm going to be with a feminist approach. Fun part was that all the guys said, no, I'm not going to play your stupid game. This is about it, whatsoever. So at the end, everybody wanted to play it, and it was a nice interaction because I think they started kind of changing perspectives. And there was another one.
I didn't want to interrupt you, but it's World Women's Day today. So.
Oh yeah, that's why you have to do it. Anyway, I'm the one with the skirt, and I'm going to continue talking now.
Sorry.
Called Death of a Martyr, and it was a young guy about 20 years old, and he said, look, I always see these postings on Facebook of my people grieving of their lost friends from school, and I want to do a LARP then which will prevent people from joining the combat, which should actually make them think beforehand and maybe eventually finding a space where they can formulate that grieving they have. Then there was another one called Damascus 2025. And it's about a scenario where there's eventually peace, but nobody knows exactly how it finished. And it was very emotional when people ended up with a sentence of saying, like, well, you left Syria and you left us behind, and this is why there's no soul in this country anymore. And for us it was a very emotional experience. We also learned that it's for young women from Syria not that easy to dance in front of strange men, which are not part of their family. And we learned that it's not all about just tackling your trauma, but just about relieving your mind and going on holiday when you do LARP.
We not only learned that, there's some more we learned. For instance, we came there and had a strong focus on Nordic LARP, and then we found out that the German LARP tradition put much more into that than we thought before.
You don't want to talk about that. Oh, all right, I don't want to talk about that, sorry. So I think one of the lessons we also drew was there's no stringent evolution of life. People enter at so many different stages, and they can come up with similar conclusions. For us, it became a bit the experience of importing and exporting LARP at the same time.
Yeah, and for me, one of the strongest things I learned is we all use the word war stories of the LARPs to describe what we went through in LARP. And actually, I can't use it anymore. Sorry. So, before Tina ends now, if you want to hear more, we will be on the Sommerkocht and talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
And now?
We have a message from our friend Bassem. He's a Syrian LARPer, of course, and that's how we want to finish.
Hello, everybody. I am Bassem from Syria. Now, I am a game master, so please prepare yourself to receive many Syrian LARP games. Thank you.